Hello, investors. It's Don Vandenborde, Senior Portfolio Manager with Revere Asset Management. Today is Friday, March 11th, 4:46 p.m. Eastern Time, coming to you from St. Augustine Beach, Florida, with the big show, the Friday edition of the Revere Market Insight video, where we take a look back at the prior week, take a look ahead at the key levels for next week, and update the world famous 21 over 21 leaders list. Let's get right into it. State of the market continues to be correction. You can see over here on the trend gauge, we are in bearish slash downtrend mode for the four segments of the market that we want to keep a track on. First one is market leaders. How are they doing? Not so good. If you take a look at any growth stocks that had a decent run in 2021, there are not really a handful of survivors that still, and you know, that I don't even know if I can fit a handful, fill up a handful with the devastation that we've seen over prior leading stocks. So bearish downtrend there. And then the five major indexes that we discuss in every video, short, they are all trending under all three of their key moving averages: the short-term 21-day, the medium-term 50-day, the long-term 200-day. Add that all up, and when you see red, no bueno for people investing in the market. Plus, we're below the key 200-day moving average, and we have been for 4 weeks now, and that speaks volumes. That's when you want to certainly. That's when risk is at its highest for the market. Now, there are some sectors, some industry groups that are holding up pretty well. There's also a lot of volatility within those, and we'll take a look at a few of them coming up when we check the chart. So what just happened today? A gap in crap with a close at the low of the day. This is basically the worst case scenario. When I did the Tuesday video, I said worst case scenario for the bulls. This one might be even worse. Because we had some good news overnight where Putin commented that there was positive, he saw some positivity from the negotiations they were having in the market. When I went to bed, we were down about 0.5%. Middle of the night, we were up about 0.5%. When I woke up, we were up 1.5%. But that faded a bit into the open, and really, those were the highs, and just a terrible day overall. G6, our growth proxy index, which is a composite of six growth ETFs, down 2.7% on the day. S&P 500 down 1.3%, NASDAQ 100 down 2.1%, Dow down 0.7%. Green for much of the day, but just could not hold up under the weight of the market into the close. Mid caps down 1%, Russell down 1.6. 60/40 worldwide diversified stock and bond down 0.81. In-house here, Grotection, our flagship portfolio, we were green for most of the day, but could not hold on and succumbed to close negative, but only negative by 0.17% on the day. Let's dig into the charts. First, let's take a look at the team here at Revere. Executing our plan to keep our clients' money safe during a downtrend. I'd say that that's what we've been doing all year. We've done a pretty good job of it. Down about 5% on the year versus down 13-14% for the S&P. Actually, I think it's 12% now. We had an up day earlier in the week, and down 16-17% for the NASDAQ 100. If you're interested in learning more about this approach, which is very critical, especially if you're approaching retirement, because of the concept of sequence of returns. You know the market returns 8-9% long term, but you don't get that every year. There's some years where it's great. There's some years where it's really bad, and you really don't want to withstand those really bad years. You want to be able to handle them, get out of the way of them. And if you're interested in this approach, you can email any of us, Dan, Tim, Hunter, Meryl, or Don at revereasset.com, or call 855 Real Wealth. That's 855-732-5932. Let's get to the tail of the tape. And let's start out Just reviewing it from the top, market state correction, headwinds continue to be US dollar, inflation, got some bad inflation data this week, Fed tapering, rising interest rates, and Russia Ukraine. Sentiment, put call, nowhere near what you want to see for a washout. You want to see this get up to 1.3, 1.4 intraday while you see a big spike in the VIX, maybe up to the 40 level, and fear and greed go to single digits. Perhaps that washout will get rid of the last of the sellers and that'll reset the decks for a rally. But as for right now, the VIX continues to be elevated, holding around 30 for quite a while now. Fear and greed, extreme fear, but not as extreme as we've seen it. So sentiment is, it's close to where it needs to be, but it hasn't had that big kick to the downside or to the upside, depending on what you're talking about. That would downside from a perspective of what the markets would do. We've had two washout days so far, but we're approaching the bottom of the second washout day. So there was not a full capitulation. There's still a bunch of sellers, and the action today dictated that. So our bull case, this failed on 3-7 when the rally failed. Can't get back above the key moving averages as you saw in the trend gauge. And then our bear case continues to be intact. That's the S&P 500 below the 200-day moving average. That happened on 217. We're now at 311, fourth weekly close. This might be, fourth weekly close below. Well, let's see, 217. Let's check the S&P 500 here. So this is the first one was 217. One, two, three. So yeah, 4 weeks below, 4 weekly closes below the key 200-day moving average slash 40-week moving average. So as I mentioned today, gap up on Putin, positive comments on negotiation. Consumer sentiment came in awful. In fact, it's down at the levels that normally dictate a recession is on the way. Now that recession might freeze the Fed from raising interest rates. But then it also opens up a whole new set of issues for us to deal with. So coming into today, again, I was watching S&P 500 against this 4290 area. Let's go to a 30-minute chart here. 4290, right below this 4300 area. You can see where it was support here in March, support here in March again. And now we failed down through it on March 7th, and every time we get to it, we're failing. Key rate, key area here. First thing we need to do is get back above 4290. In fact, overnight high 4336. So a full percent above. We opened all the way down. We faded that percent, opened at 4285, and then we just faded all day long. You can see my comment here. We gapped up 6 tenths of a percent, but we were up 1.6% overnight. By 10 a.m., we were red, and then we had three waves down during the day. Let's take a look at a 5-minute chart here, and you can see the three waves down. So here's your gap up, wave one down, we bounce, wave two down, we bounce, wave three down, and close at the low of the day. Certainly the worst case scenario again, if you're a bull. Overnight range was very wide, over 100 points. But then again, we faded and we're back below this key 4290 level. I keep talking about that. We opened at 4285 and never really challenged getting back above 4290 at all for the rest of the day. So bottom line for today and the current state of the market, gap and crap, any strength continues to be sold. We do have positions. We did take a couple more today, but we're buying them on weakness, some stronger stocks, and there are some stronger stocks today. In the 21 over 21 list, we only dropped two from last week, despite a week in the market where we were down, near 2% on the indexes. But there are pockets that are holding up. The key is to not buy them on strength, but to get them on pullbacks. And really, you gotta don't be sitting and waiting for 20% gains. You're happy if you get 8 to 12. Take it. Get your cash back to safety and wait for better days. So bottom line, gap and crap, any strength continues to be sold. So in the portfolio, we'll talk about this momentarily for because first we need to get through what the indexes are doing. And you can see here this big green line, the 21-day exponential moving average, and now that 4290 level below both of those. 21-day moving average is at 43.31, so less than basically right at a percent away from coming down to what this former support area was that has now transitioned into resistance. Again, this key 42.90 area. So let's see what happens next week. On the downside, we pretty much closed at the lower range of support here around this 4,200 area. We had one close below on this spike. This first washout that everybody said, oh, that's the bottom, that only bottomed at 42.23. Lots of work below that since then. This second washout, oh, we're at the bottom now, 41.15. So maybe we're working on this big third wave down. We undercut here, wash some more people out, three waves down. On a daily chart, certainly beats three waves down on a intraday chart. Perhaps we could see a bottom here, maybe down around the 4,000 area. That's all speculation. For right now, we take a look at the various levels and how stocks are doing, individual stocks are doing, and we then react accordingly. Cutting loss is very short. Normally, we give stocks 0.2%. We're cutting that down to closer to 0.1 to 0.12. Because we're taking profits quicker. So can't have our profits be the same size as our losses. Your profits on a per trade average need to be, even if you bat 50-50, they need to be bigger than what your average loss is. But that's a whole nother math section topic that I won't be going into today. So there's your S&P 500 key level for next week. Is this little bit of support that we've got here from the close from Tuesday, where the low, the close was 41.70, and then this 41.15 area, which was the prior washout. So break below this 41.15 could be the start of wave three down. As I said, possibly put in a bottom. We don't speculate, though. We take a look at what the market's doing. Layout scenarios. And then see what happens. You can see the three waves down here on the NASDAQ 100 is 334, 318. So the key area next week is 318.26 on the NASDAQ 100. Again, it continues to trend below our best friend, the short-term 21-day exponential moving average. Let's go to the Dow Jones Industrial Average. Very clear that you got the two waves down there too, below the 21. Just like the S&P, these two lower lows will be the next level of support, the lowest one being 322.69. Let's look at mid-caps. Big flat base is what this is looking at, and really kind of not the same. So there's been some relative strength in mid-caps. Let me get rid of this stochastic. There's been some relative strength in mid-caps. Note how they barely have undercut this first washout day, and note the relative strength line heading higher here. This is something we've been keeping an eye on. So mid-caps acting better. In fact, they challenged getting above the 21-day today, but failed there. That would have been a feather in the bull's cap if we could have closed above there, but we did not. And same thing with IWM, got one close right on it this week, closed right beneath it, tried to move ahead of Wednesday's highs, but again failed. And this is same situation. This is actually making higher lows here. So small caps and mid caps are certainly, and again, here's the relative strength line. Small caps and mid caps certainly showing some outperformance versus the bigger growth brethren, as Hunter talked extensively in his Thursday video about how big tech finally was getting hit. So those are the big areas for next week in the indexes. Now let's go on to the 21 over 21 list. And as always, first thing we want to do, we've got 13 sectors, 21 industry groups. With a crappy market like this, to be able to get 21 stocks from 21 industry groups over the 21-day is, it really wasn't even a difficult feat. In fact, I had about another 15 that were clamoring to get into the two spots that were vacated by stocks that we sold this that were kicked out because of their failure, and those two that were booted out this week. The first one is Mattel, not really a growth area, toys, but it did have its gap up on earnings, and we've discussed for a while how gaps up on earnings really don't make any progress. This one finally rolling over, breaking both the 21 and the 50-day this week. And the second one was Box, a tech stock, a computer software database, had another gap up to the top of this double bottom base. But again, what's happening with gaps on earnings? Not going anywhere. Held it for about a week and a half, and now broke the 21 and the 50 today, sitting on the 200-day moving average. So those were the two that got booted out. The two that we added to the port to the 21-21 were two that we took positions in this week. In fact, Costco we added on Wednesday, and then added a little bit to it today when it was showing some strength. That ended up being a mistake. You can see Costco had a little bit of a gap up with some volume behind it early. It was a very low risk on the downside, so we went up from 4 to 6% with it. But you can see what Costco did during the day, so we're underwater on that ad. But Costco added to the 21 over 21 list, and we own it. And FCX, really nice looking chart here. Pulled back and held the 21 on lighter volume over the last couple of days. This is one of the metal mining and metal ores. This is one of the industry groups. In fact, it's under industry group number 9 that has excelled during this sell-off. So those are the two ads this week, Costco and FCX. Let's go through the remaining 19 now. GFS, semiconductor stock, the only tech stock. Now there's actually another one. We've got a software security stock that's in there, but GFS, nice earnings, pulled back. Just overall, this looks the best of just about any semiconductor that you can find. PSA, a REIT, tried to break out. You know what's happening to breakouts, but this looks pretty good. Certainly a growth area where people putting stuff in storage and pulling back gently to the 21. Union Pacific attempted breakout, failed, pulled back to the 21. Dollar Tree attempted breakout, failed, but at the top of the range around this 150. LNTH, here's a breakout that has proceeded to go higher, but then, you know, went sideways for about a week and a half, tried to break out today and reversed, but definitely one to keep an eye on. In the medical products group, Halliburton, we bought this after a quick 2-day run up, pulled back hard, bounced off the 21. We re-entered this, and this continues to look great. Palo Alto, the other tech stock that's in there, tried to break out from a flat base, same old story, pulled back, bounced off the 50. When it got back above the 21, we bought it sideways, tight on lower volume for 2 days. Very good. But I do want to note that the two other stocks that were acting well in the computer software security group, Checkpoint CHKP and FTNT, both failed on their patterns this week. So tight stop for us on Palo Alto. Newmont, really volatile this week. This is a volatile week for oils, for gold, for fertilizers, for anything that had really been excelling with the market. So you can see the quick move up from 70 to 80 in 3 days, harsh pullback, but continues to hold the 80 MA on its way up. Nucor bounced, pulled back. We took this off the 21 this week. Again, failed breakout of the double bottom, pulls back immediately and bounced again. If it gets near the top of this range, up around 140, we'll probably lock in that low single digit gain. LNG, volatile, tried to make new highs, not quite, pulled back, held the 21 on its pullback though. Arch Coal, consolidating around this 150 area, big shakeout on Wednesday. Marathon Petroleum going sideways for a while, bounced off the 50, got back above the 21. This week, Archer Daniels Midland pulling back after this quick move up. Lockheed Martin, strongest of the security stocks. We own RTX, but this one, pretty strong pullback after getting just a little too overheated, but well above the 21. AbbVie continues to just ride the 21 higher. Berkshire undercut here on the 24th with the shakeout with the market, but has been acting great since, but tried to pull out today above this 325 level, reverse, actually above 330, reversed to close at 326.60. ZIM, one that shipping's been a very strong area, A-rated group. This had a little bit of a gap up, closed at the bottom of the range day two, held the bottom of the range, moved out today. Again, higher highs, but can you really trust anything? Do you want to buy this on strength, or would you rather it pull back to the 21 again? It's 10.7% above the 21. No way I'm touching anything that's that far ahead, above the 21. CF Industries, volatile pullback on Wednesday, right back up near this 100 area. This is the Livermore area that's been acting as resistance for it all week. And then finally, Devon. Devon continues to ride the 21 higher, tried to break out above 60, but like most oils, we had that one gap down day this week, but it bounced off the 21, hanging out around that 60 area. And there's your 21 over 21 list. I do want to go through something else, and it's the list of the ETFs that we track, and take a look at how they tried to move out this week, tried to show some strength, but they were just rejected. Now, these are the ETFs that are in the G6 plus a couple of other ones. You can see IWO today, declining 21. Got a little bit got above it last week. We had a little bit of hope after the second shakeout that something might happen, but not the best action this week. Got into the 21 twice this week and rolled over. QQQJ couldn't even get up to the 21. This really had a bad week. FFTY hanging right around the 21, but again, can't break out above it. PDP riding the 21 lower. ARK just continues to just get absolutely bludgeoned down from 126 to 5562 now. Just a brutal pullback, and you just can't hold stuff like this when actually this was even higher. Let's go back weekly in February when this peaked. It was up at the 160 area. So from 160, this was just the second pullback from 125 when we had the second stealth bear market in 2020. And then actually we've had another one. This is a 20% pullback. This is another 20% pullback. So three stealth bear markets in growth over the past 12 months. That's why we keep such an eye on some of these proxies that we developed, because we gave up more than we wanted to of our gains from 2021 and 2020. We gave up more than we wanted to in early 2021 with that first stealth bear market in growth stocks. So ARK looking terrible. MDYG, the sixth component, into the 21. Got above it a couple days last week, but this week no follow-up at all. A couple of others that we track, GK, MTUM, all looking the same. Sly G is the small cap 600. These are a little better quality stock than the Russell 2000 to be included in an S&P index. But again, being stymied at the declining 21, here's the S&P 500 growth, being stymied at the declining 21, and then these are the key five that we go through in every video. And then IJR, this is the 600 small cap. Tried to poke above the 21 again today. This one got the furthest of all of them, but ended up closing below. So until we get some cooperation with those key G6s above their 21 and their 21 turns higher, we're going to continue to be very lightly allocated. Other changes for the portfolio. We had a DIA allocation, and basically, I was not comfortable holding that considering that we were constantly being stymied at the top of the range. So we've been making a lot of use out of this stochastic indicator for entries. The best place to take an entry is when you're at the bottom here. And if you're going to take some off, you might as well take it off at the top. So this is where we got rid of our DIA this week for less than a 1% loss. And then we also got rid of our hedge. It was SPXU. Same situation. We took it off some here at the top of the range and the rest of it into the close at the top of the range. So what we're left with is seven stocks, six half positions, one full position. That's Costco. 0.54 is our adjusted beta. That we still have about 65% cash, and rolling into next week with tight stops, we're up from about 0.2, 0.25% from when we re-engaged on that last shakeout, and so playing it tight, taking single digit gains, buying at the bottom of the range, selling on any strength. That's the way to play this market. That's going to wrap it. You have any questions? As always, like to hear back from you. I'm on email at dvannenbord@revereasset.com, or you can call us 855 Real Well. So wrapping up the week ending March 11th. This is Don Vannenbord telling it like it is. Have a great weekend. Thanks for listening.